So Netflix still eludes me. Am I alone? I mean, I just don't get it. You get to see a show one episode after another. You can watch a series after a series after a series. There's this new word called binge watching. I've heard of binge eating, never really binge watching. I don't like TV. I don't watch TV. So this is all new to me. So when the teaching team got together a couple of months back and we were planning this message series, we knew that we were going to be talking about miracles. And we know that miracles could be very strange. So when someone threw out the idea of entitling the series Stranger Things, I thought, great, that's a great title. I think that just goes right along with it. But what I didn't know, and I had no idea, that this was a play on the Netflix series entitled Stranger Things. Does anybody know Stranger Things? All right, interesting. Okay, for the rest of us, I feel like I'm not alone, so I'm glad to know that. For the rest of us, here are the cliff notes. So if you're like me, you've never heard this, it's a series that is set in the 1980s, and it's in a fictional town called Hawkins, Indiana. And the deal is that there is a boy there that disappears at the same time that a whole bunch of supernatural events begin happening, including the appearance of a young girl who has supernatural powers. And the story develops in ordinary people where they move from this place of unbelief to belief in strange supernatural powers. Now, I was talking to one of my friends about this because I have to do a little research, right? I'm like, what the heck? I was talking to one of my friends, and she was telling me that as the show develops, that she said, I kept thinking to myself, I've heard this storyline someplace else. And she said, it seems like I've read about this before, that I read about a person showing up in a community with supernatural powers that move people from unbelief to belief. And then she said, it dawned on her. She read about it in the Bible, more specifically in the Gospel of John. What I love about the Bible is that we get to get four different perspectives from four different authors who tell us about Jesus from their point of view. You know what I'm talking about, right? We can see the same thing happen, a crash or something. Christina might say it one way, and I'm going to tell you a whole different story. I like to tell stories so I can embellish it a little more, and others don't. So there's four different perspectives that we get. Now, we call these writings of these guys the Gospels, which simply means the good news. So in the Gospel of Matthew, that was written to the Jews, and it focuses on religion. The Gospel of Mark was written to the Romans and focuses on power. The Gospel of Luke was written to the Greek and focuses on truth. And the Gospel of John was written to everyone and focuses on belief. And here's what each biography of Jesus has in common. You see, they each use the life, the ministry, and the teaching of Jesus to help us come to faith in him and trust their lives to him. I think that John's gospel is the Stranger Things version of Jesus' life. Matthew and Luke, they begin with the story of Jesus' birth. But John, he bypasses all of that and he dives right into the supernatural ministry of Jesus. John wrote his good news about Jesus because he wants everyone to believe in Jesus. You see, belief in Jesus is the central theme of the Gospel of John. And here's how we know it. Here's how we know it. Let's read John 20, 30 to 31 together. It's on the screen. Ready? Go. Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. So these are written, why? Why? Look at the text. That you may believe, that's right, that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. You see, John tells the strange story of Jesus so that people will believe. The word belief here is oftentimes misunderstood. You see, we can make belief a head thing where we need to have hard facts. You know, I believe it if I have the hard facts. But the Greek word here in Scripture for belief is a word called pistuo, and it means to think to be true. But it really has a deeper meaning. More than just thinking something to be true, it is to be persuaded to the point of putting one's deep and abiding trust in something or someone. This is John's aim. See, John isn't just recording history so that people will believe that Jesus was God in the flesh. He wants people to believe in Jesus, our Savior and Redeemer, our Lord of Lords, and the one who sets captives free. What's more, John wants to place their trust in Jesus. So he tells true stories about seven signs or miracles that in the human terms are absolutely unexplainable. So for the next 7 weeks, this is what we're going to talk about. So next 7 weeks leading up to Easter, we're going to look at seven stranger things, also known as miracles of Jesus. The miracle of water turning into wine, we'll find in John chapter 2, and we're going to talk about that today. The miracle of the healing of the official's son, John chapter 4. The miracle of healing of the man at the pool of Bethesda is in John chapter 5. The miracle of the feeding of 5,000, John chapter 6. The miracle of Jesus walking on water, John chapter 6. The miracle of the healing of the man born blind. We find that in John chapter 9. And the miracle of raising Lazarus from the dead, John chapter 11. You see, friends, these miracles all point to the same thing. They point to the life, the death, the burial, and resurrection of Jesus. So your homework is, over the next couple of weeks, to read John, okay? To read the Gospel of John. All right, so are you ready for some stranger things? All right, here we go. Let's begin. So John chapter 2 is where we learn that Jesus is a man that you definitely want to have at your party. Do you know why? Listen to this. On the third day, I'm going to say that again. On the third day, a wedding took place in Cana in Galilee. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine was gone, Jesus' mother said to him, "They have no more wine." "Woman, why do you involve me?" Jesus replied. "My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Nearby stood six stone water jars, the kind used by the Jews for ceremonial washings, each holding from 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, fill the jars with water. And so they filled them to the brim. And then he told them, "Now draw some out and take it to the master of the banquet." They did so, and the master of the banquet tasted the water that had been turned into wine. He did not realize where it had come from, though the servant who had drawn the water knew. And then he called the bridegroom aside and he said, "Everyone brings out the choice wine first and then the cheaper wine after the guests have had too much wine to drink. But you have saved the best till now." What Jesus did here in Cana of Galilee was the first of the signs through which he revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. Now, John is a slick guy, and if you noticed, he began by saying, "On the third day." What else happened on the third day? Amen, right? So on the third day, Jesus rose from the dead. Now, this is not written by accident by John. It's not an accident. You see, what he's doing is he's pointing to what Jesus would ultimately do on Easter. So Jesus is with some of his disciples at a wedding in a small village called Cana. Now, when we make our guest list, right, we make our guest list based upon how many we can invite, based upon how much money we have that we can pay for the seats, right, to feed people one meal and to and provide drinks for them. But in Jesus' day, the whole village is invited, and the party lasts for a whole week. So here's the deal. Things are rolling right along, and all of a sudden, there's big trouble. There's big trouble. Read it with me. It's on the screen. Ready, go? The wine supply ran out during the festivities. So Jesus' mother told him, they have no more wine. No more wine. Can you imagine? This is an embarrassment for the couple and for the families. This is a huge crisis. It's not a little deal. It is a big deal because their reputations are on the line. Because you see, the custom and the understanding of the day was that the host would provide the food and drink for the entire week. I think John is using this crisis as a metaphor to point to a more deeper spiritual crisis in our lives. Think about it for a minute. Episcopalian priest Mike Marsh writes this. He says, there comes a day when the wine gives out, the glass is empty, the party is over. On that day, life seems empty and dry. There is no vibrancy or vitality. Nothing is growing or fermenting within us. Our world is colorless and tasteless. The bouquet of life is absent, and we are living less than fully alive. Some of us right now might be feeling empty, dry, lifeless, colorless, tasteless, and maybe even joyless. And we long for the fullness and the vibrancy and the joy. But John and Jesus want to help us here with this, with the rest of the stories, as we watch Jesus strangely transform water into wine. Consider this question. How does believing in Jesus miraculously transform my empty life? If you're taking notes, I want you to write the word quantity on your message notes. Quantity. Because you see, Jesus wants to transform the quantity of good things in my life. He wants me to move from an attitude of lack to an acknowledgement of abundance. Let's look at how he does this in John 2, verse 6 and 7. It says this, standing nearby were six stone water jars used for Jewish ceremonial washing. Each could hold 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus told the servants, fill the jars with water. John tells us that these jars are not just some ordinary clay pots, but they are six big stone jars that are used for religious cleansing ceremonies. These six jars would hold somewhere between 120 and 180 gallons. Now, that's a large quantity of liquid. Remember, they were in the desert, so in the religious ceremonies, they would use a cup of water to symbolically cleanse about 100 people. It's said that there was enough water in these six jars to cleanse the entire world, literally. The quantity of Jesus' transformation is unlimited and incalculable. John wants us to know that God's grace is not limited at all. There's so much that it is immeasurable. You see, he pours out it lavishly on everyone, and it never runs out, and that's abundance. His grace fills every need that you have. His grace is sufficient for every problem you face. His grace has brought you safe thus far, and His grace will lead you home. Amen. You see, this grace is free and it's unconditional. No strings attached. But Jesus, He wants to do more than to just save us. He wants to do more. He wants us to bear fruit in this life. And He wants us to live a life that is more than we can have ever hoped for. And there's only one way to do that. Only one way. Just hours before Jesus went to the cross, He gathered His 12 apprentices and He taught them one last thing. And here's what He said. Yes, I am the vine and you are the branches. And those who remain in me and I in them will produce much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. You see, Jesus is teaching them once again, and He says, apart from me, you can't do anything. You can't do anything, nothing. He just wanted us now and them then to know that without Him in our lives, we will be empty, we will be dry, we will be lifeless and joyless and colorless and tasteless. But here's the deal. If we learn to abide in Jesus, if we connect to Him, if we believe in Him, if we trust Him, we can have life to the fullest with vibrancy and joy. So how's the quantity of your life right now? Are you empty or are you full? Is your life in Christ abundant? The second way Jesus can transform my life is that, number two, Jesus can give me a superior new life. Again, if you're taking notes, I want you to write the word quality here, quality, on your message notes. You see, Jesus not only can change the quantity of your life from empty to full, but He can also change the quality of your life from inferior to superior. So look what happens in the next story in John chapter 2, verse 7b. It says this, when the jars had been filled, He said, now dip some out and take it to the master of ceremonies. So the servants followed the instructions, and when the master of ceremonies tasted the water that was now wine, not knowing where it had come from, though of course the servants knew, he called the bridegroom over. A host always serves the best wine first, he said. And then, when everyone has had a lot to drink, he brings out the less expensive wine. But you have kept the best until now. Do you see what's going on here? So the servants do just what Jesus says. He fills the water jars, and they take a cup full, and they give it to the master of ceremonies to taste test it. Somehow, the water is transformed into this very expensive wine. Not the paper box kind of wine. No, this is superior wine. It's the best available. But here's the interesting question to ponder. When did the miracle happen? Was it when the servants filled the jar with water? Was it when they dipped the cup? Maybe it happened when the master of the ceremonies drank it. We're not told, but the miracle, the sign pointing to the resurrection of Jesus happened. This miracle is also a metaphor for what Jesus wants to do in your life if you'll let Him. When I was a kid, There was a room in my aunt and uncle's house that we dared not enter without permission. You may know what I'm talking about. It was a formal living room that was visited only by adults when family members, when special guests were there. You know what I'm talking about, right? It was such a special room that my aunt and uncle, they had all the furniture covered in plastic. It was awesome. You know, we weren't allowed in there anyways, but it was covered in plastic. So in the middle of what we called the forbidden zone was a coffee table with a bowl of plump, juicy purple grapes, and they looked so good. Well, one day, our parents were out in the backyard, and my cousin and I took off our shoes, and we tiptoed in the living room like jewel thieves. Right? We went in there, we went into the living room, and I plucked one of those grapes off because they looked so good for so many years, and I ate it. It was awful. It was terrible. It looked so good, but it was terrible. It was plastic. It was fake. It was fake. But sadly, the bowl of artificial fruit represents many of our lives. It looks attractive and lifelike, but you come to find out that it's just fake. Jesus wants to give us something real. He wants to give us something real. In that same message to his disciples just hours before going to the cross, and right after inviting us to abide in him, Jesus says these words in John 15:4, I want you to read them with me. Ready? Go. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. For a branch cannot produce fruit if it's severed from the vine, and you cannot be fruitful unless you remain in me. You see, Jesus wants us to know that the quality of our lives will not be fruitful apart from getting and staying connected to him. He gives us the capacity to live our lives that are fruitful and lives that truly matter. Jesus invites us to give up lifeless religion and to take up abiding, life-giving relationship with him. Father Mike Marsh says it best when he wrote this. He said, regardless of how it feels or what we think about, the day that the wine runs out is the beginning of a miracle. You see, Christ does not simply refill our glasses. He transforms our lives, turning water into wine. It is, after all, the third day, the day of resurrection and new life. That which was colorless is now vibrant red. That which has no taste now tingles the tongue. And that which had no fragrance now has a full bouquet. That which had no life is now fermenting, active, and alive. So is your life overflowing and abundant? Is it excellent and superior? Or is it fake like those grapes? For way too many of us, we're living this kind of joyless, empty, inferior lives. And this Lent, Jesus invites us to abide in him and to bear good fruit. I asked some of these helpers to help me out, Bill and some of the guys to come help me out, because maybe this illustration might help you. As they're bringing this up, I want you to think about what condition is your spiritual life? What condition is your spiritual life? You see, I've got these three glass jars that represent three possible spiritual conditions of our life today. The first jar is empty. There's nothing in it. Have you ever been there? 25 years ago, I found myself in a place feeling like I had no purpose, no passion for anything. My soul was empty. I had no direction for my life. I was lost. Is this how you would describe maybe how you're feeling today? Empty, no purpose, no passion, no real direction. Maybe today, for the first time, you'll consider a relationship with Jesus. It would be my honor to pray with you. The second glass jar is filled with water. It's just plain old water. Plain, tasteless, colorless, bland, plain water. I don't like water. I never did. It's plain water. I mean, water is good because, I mean, we need it to survive. But if you're like me, you need some kind of flavor in it. You see, in my journey following Jesus, there have been times that my walk with Jesus has been bland and tasteless. You know what I mean, right? I know I'm not alone. I talk to way too many of you. And maybe for you, maybe that's you today. But here's what I came by to say. Doesn't have to be. Doesn't have to be. The third jar is filled with this rich, delicious, vibrant juice. It's filled, and it's awesome. It smells good, and it tastes great. And it not only quenches our thirst, but it brings us delight. Abiding in Jesus is an invitation to regularly taste and see that the Lord is good. Are you living this rich and joyful life in Christ? You see, friends, this morning we have a choice. We have a choice. Which glass will it be?